one thing we've been discussing since he's been here, about how it takes about 10,000 hours for someone to become competent or an expert at something. And this fellow here has at least 10,000 miles on the trail, either by walking or hollering at the bottom. So I think he would qualify to have something to share with us. So at that, I'd like to introduce one tough pole, Tom Jungle.
Okay. Thank you, Don. So I'd like to begin by just talking a little bit about the reality of adventure. I feel we desperately need adventure in our lives. It may be our only hope, really, in the society that we live in, to have adventures. However, our dreams of adventures bear little to no resemblance of what really happens when we think what's going to happen in our adventure, and we actually get out there and start experiencing the real world of engaging in the outdoors. So this is it. Now, I am very happy to be here. I have always wished to sit around a campfire and have an audience that I could tell stories to. I can't tell you how many times I've mentioned to someone that, well, I kind of like spent 6 months hiking 2,700 miles, and I expect they're going to, you know, talk to me and just kind of, well, tell us all about it. I usually get two questions. Did you go alone? And did you carry a gun? That's basically it. Over. Let's move on. You know, let's go to Walmart or something like that. So tonight, what I'm going to do is, I am going to include thoughts about me, why I walk, and basically I'm going to talk about walking specifically on snow. And we're going to get there. I've been, I was a backpacker that did winter backpacking when I was younger, and then I kind of gave it up for a while, and then I got into it again when I got into my 40s. And then I met Garrett Conover at the Common Ground Fair, and I ended up taking a couple of trips with him, and I never backpacked again in the wintertime cold. From that point on, I gave it up, and I got a tent, I built five toboggans, and I go out every winter for at least a week on my own, usually in Maine, and I haul my toboggan, and you know, I have fun in the outdoors. So when I went on these trips, they were summertime trips, but they involved quite a bit of snow travel that I'll talk about. I'd like to talk about, quickly mention my sponsors. I'm sponsored by SteriPen, which is a water purification company. It's an ultraviolet light device. I've received gear from the Maine Patagonia store. They helped me out quite a bit. I'm sponsored by New Balance. These are boots that I used on my hike. These are the exact number of a pair that I wore out in 2013 when I hiked from Mexico to Canada on the Continental Divide Trail. And my primary sponsor just happens to be Four Dog Stove. So I'd like to thank Don for all the help that he's given me over the past approximately 4 years. He believed in me right from the start, and he was willing to help me out with material from his catalogs, and I was able to purchase a lot of freeze-dried food from him, and very basically gave it to me. So I really appreciate Don and what he has done to support me. So this is just a photograph of the gear that I took on my trail. This was the photograph from this last trip, which was in 2013. So I have got my pack weight down now to approximately 15 pounds on my back, minus food and water. So what you're seeing here is, you know, sleeping bag. I use a down bag. I've got a X-bed three-quarter, I'm kind of shorty pad. I've got a two-pound tent. I've got Don's LT1 stove. And I've got all various kinds of gear here. I've got a bunch of electronic stuff. I wish I had a pointer. I don't have a pointer, but anyhow, let's just move on here. I'll get out of the way here as well. Am I blocking the picture when I talk? Oh yeah, okay. So somebody needs to kind of tell me that. All right. So I showed some early ability to want to be in the outdoors. This is a picture of me as Davy Crockett at 5 years of age, tap dancing my way across the stage with a, you know, a background of a wilderness scene. And I got my little coonskin cap on, and it's kind of what I do now. It's kind of what I like to do most. So I got a big smile then. I kind of have a big smile now for carrying through with that.
What year was that?
That year was 1955. Yep. I was 5 years old. So I want to talk about a couple of other things here too. Throughout my life, I was not a great athlete. I was kind of middle of the road. I wasn't really great at anything. I was a substitute for all 3 years that I was in Little League. I was too heavy to be a long distance runner. When I went to Monsignor Coyle High School, I ended up weighing about 235 pounds. And I was all set to be starting tackle my senior year. And we had our physical, and we got the doctor grabbing me, and he said, "Mr. Jamrog, you won't be playing this year. You got a hernia." So never had that chance to shine in the football. As it turns out, I'm pretty lucky that I never went that path with all the talk now about concussions and whatever. Maybe it was protective experience for me. I was too heavy to play basketball. I couldn't jump too much. But I was always comfortable outside. I grew up on a dairy farm, a small dairy farm. My grandparents, we lived with them. They were from Poland. So I was basically outside all the time as a kid, you know, in Massachusetts. And I worked for 50 cents an hour from the ages of 10 to about 13. I worked my way up to 70 when I was 13, planting vegetables and picking stuff at a neighbor's farm. Reading was discouraged in my house during the summertime. Being on a farm, if you were caught reading, you were told, "Oh, you got nothing to do? We'll find something for you to do. Go pick rocks," which is basically one of the main activities I had as a kid. Interesting now, I live in a field that's surrounded with gigantic stone walls, so maybe there's something good that happened with that. So just some facts. I completed my initial hike of the Appalachian Trail in 2007. I completed the Pacific Crest Trail, which is Mexico to Canada through California, Oregon, and Washington in 2010. I did the Long Trail in 2011, which is the length of Vermont. And I finished the Continental Divide Trail last September 18th. In those 6 years, I walked approximately 8,000 miles along these national scenic trails. I've had a great time of that, and most of it has been fairly pleasant. When I think about it, I kind of usually remember the bad stuff, and I call it euphoric recall. I can only recall the goodness that happened to me. But many of the times that I did, there was quite a bit of adversity. I've slept over 500 nights on snow, ice, rocks, even occasionally on some soft pine needles. So on October 24th of this year, I was given what's called the Triple Crown of Hiking Award by the American Long Distance Hiking Association. It's a club with only 230 members in the world who have hiked all three of these trails, so it's not a big group. So I'm pretty much obsessed with walking. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So I want to do a little bit about walking here. I also want to mention that I'm Polish, and maybe Moores would agree with this. This is a picture of the Polish mountain climbers who was specialized in winter ascents of Himalayan 8,000 foot peaks. That was their specialty. No one can suffer like these guys. And I kind of kid around that I have the Polish suffering gene. It doesn't seem to bother me to go through adversity. I kind of like thrive on it. My wife says, anything you do for fun, you've got to do a lot of suffering as part of whatever the program is. So let's talk about walking. Most of America right now is on some kind of a weight loss program. But And hiking really helps with that for me. I don't really have to be on a weight loss program. I'll talk to you about that. And basically, let's see. 50% of Americans now are considered either obese or overweight. And in these hiking programs that I've been on, I was eating as much as possible of the highest fat foods that you could, especially Fritos. I mean, is this a plant? That's like my ultimate caloric. That's 1,600 calories in that bag. I've memorized all the caloric figures for things like Pringles, Fritos, certain kinds of pastries. That's good stuff right there. On my hikes, I lost between 25 and 33 pounds. And I basically had no body fat at the end. So I learned a lot of survival skills. I know you guys have talked here about bushcraft and survival skills. Life is pretty pleasant when things don't go wrong. But what about when things get dangerous? And that's what I'm going to talk a little bit about here. I started hiking, I'm not going to talk about the Appalachian Trail. I want to talk about the other two long distance trails because that's where I really encountered snow. So that's what I'm going to be limited to. When I started hiking in the desert in Southern California, it was over 100 degrees on April 17th, and that night it went down below freezing. So the array of gear that you have to select if you don't want to carry very much is kind of interesting. So there's often no time in one of these hikes either to get a learning curve going on. You're basically, you know, you're just hitting it and you're starting to go. So there's a lot of people that are stories about people that go through adventures. And I'm not in the class, but you know, we got Daniel Boone, we got Shackleton. People love reading about adventures. And they're often very unexpected. So humans have the ability here to be prestigious walkers. And it's got to do with our hunter-gatherer history. Modern society puts us at a huge disadvantage because of what we have to do every day that prevents us from really exerting a lot of physical activity in our world. This is some members of a modern day tribe in Africa called the Hazda. And they're from Tanzania. They basically walk an average of 9 miles a day as an adult. And in that 9 miles, they're gathering food, they're basically climbing trees, they're digging for roots, and they're burning off approximately 1,500 calories a day. And there's other groups, the Bushmen of the Kalahari, the same thing. This is our history. This is a part of what our biology has experienced, you know, millions of years in the past in the evolutionary pathway. Typically, the U.S. Average U.S. person weighs about 50% less than these people, who weigh about 130, 140 pounds, 50% more, excuse me, and we work 75% less. We're only burning about 750 calories a day as we go about our activities. So the average American now commutes 32 miles a day by car, and that's replaced walking in our history. The average American now eats one-third of their meals outside the home, and we're driving to those meals as well. I was just at the airport in Detroit and also the airport here in Minneapolis-St. Paul, and I don't take the escalators. I take the stairs. Only 3% of people who frequent malls will take the stairs. Everybody else, I didn't see anybody else taking the stairs in those two airports, by the way. So what's happened? We've got food processors, we've got dishwashers, we've got vacuum cleaners, we've got clothes washers, we have dryers. They substantially reduce our former level of activity to practically nothing. So we're too physically idle. We tend to gain weight, and In Maine, I live in the most obese state in New England. Maine has an obesity rate of 29%, with 65% of my state's population, technically overweight as well. So the good news is that there's a common misperception that as we get older, we can't move anymore. And I see some gray hair here. So what I'm going to say now might mean something to you. And it's current research used to say that we lose about 10% of our muscle mass per decade after the age of 40, and it just goes downhill from there. But some of the modern research that I've been seeing lately says that if you look at athletes, older athletes, there are individuals basically in their 70s and 80s that still have the exact same thigh muscle dimensions that 40-year-olds do. So there's new stuff coming out saying that if we keep using our bodies, we are not going to be decrepit. We don't have to end up in a rocking chair. Listening to people talk about adventures, we can still keep having them. So this is what I'm trying to get across here. I'm trying to give you some hope. I was riding bikes this summer. You might have seen me riding these fat bikes out here. This is like so great to come here and be able to do this. What an awesome thing that was, those guys came. I was riding with a 17-year-old guy from Rhode Island. The guys I was riding with, I ride with a group of guys. You know, sometimes we get up a group of like 10 or 15, 40-year-olds to 50-year-olds. He was first. You know, at 72, his face looked kind of wrinkled, but if you looked at him from the neck down, you couldn't tell he was 72 years old. That's hopeful. That's a good thing. Lest we forget, this lady here, Grandma Gatewood, didn't start her three complete through hikes of the Appalachian Trail until she was 67 years old, and that's after she birthed 13 children, and basically suffered daily physical abuse from her bastard of a husband for her whole life. So, and by the way, this is a brand new 2014 book. I highly recommend this book. It is, you cannot put this down. And anybody that wants to talk to me afterwards about any of the things that I'm speaking with, you know, please do. So let me say a couple of other things. After 40 years of going to the gym, I don't do it anymore. This is my new gym, the outdoors, okay? This is my new gym. And maybe you do it too, okay? So no more treadmills, no more step machines, no more kettlebells for me. I like cutting my own wood now. I live on a 5-acre wood lot right next to my property. I have five acres of woods. I like splitting my own wood. I like putting it in a wheelbarrow. I got a little tractor, but I don't do it. I want to put it in that wheelbarrow and kind of wheel it into my woodshed. So let's talk about something else, vitamins and supplements. For years, vitamins were considered a low-level protection against whatever might come your way to screw you up. You pop one if you're worried. You want to make sure you're getting the right nutrients. You'll be healthier. Maybe you'll be stronger. Maybe you'll be faster. The problem is, there's a lot of theory behind that, but there really isn't a lot of proof that vitamins will really do what they say they're going to do for you. So eating good, healthy food like we have here and just being aware of not putting too many things that aren't vitamins in your body, I think, is a much better way to go. I used to spend up to $150 a month on supplements, and that's down to zero. All I take now is just vitamin D and a baby aspirin. I've never been sick for one day of my hikes, and I think that's pretty cool. A lot of people do get sick out there. We're around a lot of dirt. We're around a lot of filth. We're around a lot of germs from other hikers that aren't that clean, but I made out okay with that. So I want to talk a little bit about mental preparation. And this is Tom Brady. I'm a Patriots fan. And I know they're playing Chicago tomorrow. I'm hoping I can kind of see a little bit of the game. But this is our quarterback, Tom Brady. Of course, he's on.
Which one?
Yeah. what's that?
Which one's Tom?
Yeah. Which one's Tom? That's really good. So on September 6th in the Bangor News, Tom was injured, and he said, physically I took the day off, but I got in a lot of extra film in. I did a lot of mental reps that day. So he was training his brain by, looking at game films, and he was somehow doing mental repetitions of throws or something like that. So what I primarily believe we have to do to prepare ourselves to be good in the outdoors and not to have problems is primarily to address anxiety. We need techniques that will allow us not to be so anxious about what might happen to us, what might be going on at the moment, and to think about things that caused us as anxiety that tend to compromise our abilities. A lot of people attempt to hike the Appalachian Trail every year, several thousand, but only 10 to 20% make it to the end. Most people drop out, 80%, and the reason isn't physical. Most people can make it for a month, and after a month, you're in great shape. Yet you will then start seeing people drop out after that point because they just don't like it, they get bored, they get homesick, and they don't have the mental capacity to see it as a positive experience anymore. So it's negative and they basically drop out. So in my career, I was and I still part-time a professional psychologist, and I have a lot that I have to do in my career about organizing our ability to anticipate situations and rallying our emotional and mental faculties to address that. And studies have shown that interacting in nature has a tremendous effect on that ability to organize ourselves and to see things a little more perceptively. What's really incredible is it isn't even necessary to be out in nature to have those kinds of beneficial effects. It's also possible to have those effects if you're just looking at pictures of nature that has a different effect on our physiology than it would if we're in like a sterile room and exercising. It's fascinating stuff. As we're hiking, we're really working our cognitive abilities to solve a lot of problems every moment of the day. You're constantly assessing your surroundings. You're basically monitoring the weather. You're looking for animals. You're scanning around for you. I'm basically looking not to fall. That's my primary thing I'm doing. I don't want to trip up on a root or a rock or something like that. I want to really be focused, and this is a great activity to improve your focus. We hear a lot of talk about not sweating when we're out in the wintertime, and it's essential, but we've really got to be aware that we are sweating, and sometimes we might notice it too late, and then we have put it off, and then we're going to be in trouble as we start to get cold because we didn't address it early on. I think one of the greatest things that I've learned, I'm going to give you a few tips, is don't put off a task if you're in the wilderness. There's a lot of examples of thinking. I mean, if you read Garrett and Alexandra's books that are for sale out there, they talk about the times that they've like remembered that they had kind of like either a glove that should have been strapped down a little bit better on their toboggan, or a thermos wasn't in the right place, and it was, well, when I stop later, I'll fix it, only to find a few miles later it was gone, and then they had to backtrack a couple miles to retrieve it and come back again. So one of the things I'm trying to do better is when I think of something intuitively that I feel like I should be doing, I actually do that. So what else we got here? Okay, this is the most important book that I now believe helped me on my last trail experience. It's called Improv Wisdom, and here's what it's all about. The quote is from Charles Darwin. It's not the strongest that survives, nor the most intelligent is the one that is the most adaptable to change. That's my new mantra. It isn't keep pushing. It isn't just drive yourself. It's if you're getting signals that something's coming a little difficult, you may not always want to keep pushing. You may want to evaluate, is there another message here that I can kind of hear that allow me to maybe get around this obstacle, perhaps even retreat from the obstacle, or to think about the situation in a completely different way. I highly recommend this book. So, a couple of other things here. This is part of the improvising. I don't know if you can see it. It's me and another buddy, and the sign is, please do not pick up hitchhikers in this area. So, yeah. So well, there's some stupid stuff that I do out here. And we really didn't understand why it was dumb to hitchhike until we walked another 4 miles and we walked right past a prison that we didn't know existed there. This is back in New Mexico. So you may want to pay attention to some of the signs that you find along the trail. This is it. So let's talk about weight of one's pack. Here's someone with a fairly large pack. It's been said, this is what I've heard, the weight of one's pack often reflects the number and the quantity of fears that someone has about what the outdoors will bring to them. So people bring things that they think will protect them against any possible anticipated situations, and you end up with this kind of thing. It may not be necessary to carry that much stuff. Okay, this is one of the worst feet and blistered losses of toenails that I've ever seen. And let me talk about the daily inventory of pain. This is one of the things that a friend of mine called Pat, he was a Canadian guy I hiked with, we call him Pat Burglar. When you're a backpacker and you wake up in the morning, you got stuff that's hurting, okay? Every day it's something new. So you climb out of your sleeping bag, you kind of unzip, you basically get yourself out of the tent, you stand up. Okay, sometimes it's kind of like hard to stand up, other times you're standing up pretty good. Every long distance hiker to some degree has pain after we do this for months at a time. And what you do is you kind of decide, well, what? Let me get a daily inventory of my pain. For me, here's the run through. It's usually some combination of lower left back, forefoot numbness, fissured and cracked heels, tenderness or actual sprain of one or both ankles, tender shins, inflammation of one or both shoulders, a dull headache, thirst, digestive distress, chapped lips, page two, minor lacerations, cracked fingers, or outright fatigue. So when I do the daily, is this familiar with anybody? Anybody?
You said you never were sick. How could you tell?
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, that's good. How could I tell? I was. Let's put it this way. Pain is not something you can avoid. Suffering you can. So I was in pain at times, but I tried not to let it be suffering. I tried to, you know, put a limit on it. I will say I never had things like diarrhea or, you know, those kinds of things, or flu or anything like that. So why we do that is we gauge what that day would be like. That might be a day if I had a lot of things on my inventory of pain that it would be a low mileage day as opposed to a high mileage day. I'm really rolling on here like a steamroller. I just want to settle myself down and maybe give you a chance to ask some questions. And, you know, I've got a bit of time and we'll take a few questions now. And if there's no questions, I'll go on and then we can open up later. But does anyone have any questions at this point? Thank you.
Did you bring your boots with?
Did I what?
Did you bring your boots with?
Did I bring them here?
Yeah,
I have one. I was wearing them today. I mean, I don't know if you see my party shoes. I don't get a chance to go out much, so I've got these rainbow New Balance running shoes here, and I don't know if I can hold them up. But yeah, I bought a pair of boots. You can take a look at them. I'm pretty.
Tell us something about them.
The boots are very light. They got a Vibram sole. There is absolutely no membrane in them. They are not waterproof. They got large sections that have complete mesh in them, down in the forefoot and all the way wrapping up around the ankle. They're not that high. When the wind blows, I feel my feet get cool. So I also have not gotten a blister on the last 5,000 miles of hiking. And the reason why I feel like I haven't gotten a blister is because the boots shed moisture really quickly. And that's why I like them. I really like them. Plus, a lot of hikers now are going to a much lighter kind of trail runner type of shoe. It's kind of got a softer sole. You feel a lot through the bottom of the foot. I like these boots because it's a rigid, rigid sole. It bend and flex. You can see it. You can come over to Ford Dog. I'll show it to you tomorrow. But I like it because I don't feel the stones, and I can just kind of keep a. I like to keep a straight track when I hike. I don't like to kind of like avoid stones. I like to walk right over the top of them. I'm kind of like a steamroller, you know, when I go down the trail. Good question. Yes.
Did your foot do well?
That's not my foot. Yeah, well, the guy, he wasn't from the United States. This guy was from Europe, so I don't know what they do over there. Yeah. This is really interesting, because this guy was a veteran of the Israeli military, and he still had terrible feet, and this was on the Pacific Crest Trail. Okay, any other questions?
What's your longest mileage day?
The longest mileage day on the Appalachian Trail was 25 miles. My longest mileage day on the Pacific Crest Trail was 41 miles. And my longest mileage day on the Continental Divide Trail was 38 miles.
Wow.
Yeah.
What's your average then?
I averaged 12 miles a day on the Appalachian Trail, 19 miles a day on the Pacific Crest Trail, and 20 miles a day on the Continental Divide Trail. I was out for approximately 150 days for those last two hikes. Yep.
How would you rate your level of fitness before you started?
Oh, that's a good one. That's where the adaptation and improvisation works in. I thought I was in pretty good shape until I started, I wasn't tremendously, I try on my hikes to be able to hike 12 miles with 25 pounds on my back. And I live in coastal Maine, and I've got some 1,000-foot, you know, like mountains where I live. And if I can do that, I'm ready to start these hikes. You know, I will not start with the higher mileage. I'll try for a couple weeks to keep it around 12 miles. And we're walking all day, so if you take rest, you can usually do that. But on this last hike, I got another hernia. You know, on February 22nd, I thought I had one. I checked it in December. My doctor said no. I didn't believe her. I went to a specialist. He says, you got a hernia. And I was leaving on April 16th. So I had the surgery, and I couldn't lift anything heavier than 10 pounds for about 6 weeks. I only had 14 actual days to prepare to hike before that one. So it was really a bit rougher, and I was in some pain in my abdomen that eventually went away, but it worked out. Yeah. Question.
What are the socks you wear, and do you switch during the day, shoes and socks?
Great question. I'll repeat the question. What are the socks you wear, and do you switch out socks or boots during the day when you walk? I'm a total convert to Darn Tough socks out of Vermont, D-A-R-N-T-O-U-G-H. They cost $20 a pair, but they're guaranteed for life, and they're wool, and they come in different kinds of thicknesses. And this is the truth, I only had two pairs of socks. Someone the other night said they had two pairs of socks for every day out of 15 days, so that's 30 pairs. I had two pairs of socks that I wore for 5 months, and they did not get a hole in the sole. They had a small hole, each one, around my ankle. And when I finished the hike, I washed them, I sent them to the president, which is what you're supposed to do. He sent me back right away two other pairs, exact same color, exact same weight of the socks. And that can go on for the rest of my life. So, and I do switch them out during the day. I tend to keep the one pair on my backpack drying out, and then like two or three times a day, I'll let the sun dry them out if there's sun, and then switch them out as I go. I really want dry feet. I really want to shed moisture. Any other questions?
You mentioned mental challenges. Sometime would you talk about dealing with being alone for such a long period?
Okay.
And whether you think that's a personality ability or whether it's something you can do.
Okay, the question was, can you talk about mental challenges of being alone, and is it a personality characteristics or whatever? On these hikes, I prefer not to hike alone. I have found a couple of guys that I really like hiking with. And they're younger guys. They're like 29 and 33. And I found them on the AT. I found them the second day on the Appalachian Trail. We finished the last day together. 3 years later, they were interested in going on the Pacific Crest Trail. We completed that together. And while we finished and started together, there were many days that I wasn't with them, because some people might want to go town for a day, some people want to go ahead, so you might break it up. But during the day, it's largely on my own. You are hiking on your own during the day, and I like to be around other people at night. I'm a social person, and that's how I like to do it. So I didn't spend a lot of time alone. I did, my most terrifying time alone was two nights where I got lost and separated from my buddies up in the Rocky Mountains in Colorado. And I started to get really panicky. And what was worse about it is, I didn't know when I went back on the trail. I did eventually find my way back. I put myself to sleep. I settled myself down. I stopped wandering around. And then I was much clearer in the morning, and I could figure out with my maps where I might have been. But I didn't know whether at that point they would be ahead of me or they would be behind me. So it was really, really kind of, that was probably the most frightening thing that I did. But I feel generally very comfortable walking alone during the day. Any other questions? Just take. I didn't hear you. Oh yeah, oh yeah. I saw many animals, and I will talk about that in my hike. I'll show you, you know, some of the days. I'll mention what the animals were certain days. I saw grizzly bears. I encountered grizzlies. I saw, you know, didn't see any wolves, but I saw wolf tracks. I saw lots of elk, hundreds of elk. I saw moose. I saw lots and lots of deer. I saw a few turtles, which is kind of cool. All right. Okay. I think what I'll do is I'll go ahead and maybe I'll stop again for some questions after I go for a while. So, let's see here. So let's talk about a couple of other things about walking, and then I'll get into the specifics of the trails. So walking not only burns calories, but it improves mood. And really great research now on just what you're doing now and how dangerous it is for us to be sitting, and how unhealthy it is for us to be sitting for portions of the day. A new study has found that just an hour of sedentary behavior increases people's risk of being able to perform basic functions as you age. So, and that's independent of being on an exercise program. Small movements during the day, standing, walking around, you know, just now when I take a phone call, I'm sure to kind of like walk, and we have these cell phones, you can kind of walk around when you take phone calls or whatever. But you really want to take a look at some of, do some Googling on sitting, and it'll encourage you not to sit as much as you really probably are now. So I like to talk a little bit about weight loss, and then I'm going to move on to the hikes. So walking burns calories. I told you I burned from 27 to about 33 pounds on each of my hikes. And what I try to imagine initially was how I tried to visualize that losing that much weight. And I tended to, for a while, convert it to sticks of butter. So 25-pound weight loss is 100 sticks of butter piled up here that shaved off of what was my body, but it would be your body or anyone's body. It's kind of startling when you think of it that way. But I found something even better, which is a prop that I will bring out now. This is an actual lab sample rubber of what a pound of fat looks like. You know, so I don't know, I'll pass it around. You can kind of take a look at it. That's, throw it around, whatever. It's pretty gross. It's pretty gross looking. And so anyhow, you take the weight off when you walk around like that. I'm going to move ahead a little bit. Okay. So this is a picture of me before and after. And the picture on the left is me at around 215 pounds. And the picture of me is on the right at about 189 pounds. And you can sort of see that's the loss of 100 sticks of butter. So not only do you lose the fat from your, you know, surface of your body, you're losing it internally. It's pushing itself in the organs in your body. It's inside. Most of the fat's in your body. So I'll move along from that slide. So here's some interesting stuff about walking speed, which I never realized. And this is Thomas Jefferson, and I'll blow that up. And it's, there it is. This is from Thomas Jefferson, our third president. And guess what? It's true. If you want to really get most out of the bang for your miles, you want to be moving fairly quickly when you walk. You're going to burn the same amount of calories to cover a mile if you walk really slow or really fast, but your physiology will be processing that energy expenditure much differently if you walk quickly. So what's the pace? It should be at least 3 miles an hour, maybe 3.2 miles an hour is about the cut point when that seems to make a difference in the studies that I've seen. Slow walking is not a bad thing, but if you want to walk for health and you want the benefits of some physiological changes to happen metabolically, you want to be going at a little bit of a clip. So let's talk some more about biology quickly. And so you can see what's going on here. I believe that when I'm out there hiking, scanning for what's going on, moving through the forest, as you probably are, moving through your wilderness, that we are exercising a fight or flight mechanism as we're walking. Any biological system, even if it's an amoeba, basically either is acting to get something, be it food, a mate, some object now that we're brainwashed to think that we need to purchase because we see it in a magazine and we'll lay out our credit card, which we might have exorbitant rates and we're paying them, but we still want it. So we're either grabbing and getting something, or we're trying to escape something, push something away. It's that simple, and I think that's what we're doing, you know, in many of our different functions that we have during the day. And sometimes it's very profound, and it's automatic, as it would be if you encountered this guy coming at you on the trail, and it would just trigger your biology, would just start flooding with biochemicals. And what's really, we're back to the mental thing here again, what's really important is we know from experience that it's easier to remember negative experiences than positive. And that's basically a protective mechanism for us because we need self-protection, and we have built into us the ability to kind of like sense danger and then, you know, react to that danger. So I think we need to take time to create some positive feedback to ourselves so we don't get negative, you know, about what we're thinking about. Here's what I think. I'm kind of trying to explain to you what I think happens. I feel like when I'm walking at a pretty good clip, and I've been out in the woods for more than a month, I might be month one, might be month two, three, four, I'm kind of in a primal perception zone. I'm not thinking about my problems at the office. They're gone. That life is totally gone. I had, and this was driven home to me one time when I was out for a week, and I was totally stressed out by some really bad experience I had at work. And I'd been out a week, and I was talking to a friend of mine, and we were doing something, maybe hiking the trail in Maine or something, and he says, you know, you were going to talk to me about something that happened to you. Let's talk about that now. So we're walking. I said, oh, yeah, you won't believe it. I could not remember what I was upset about. I could not remember. I was in a different world once you start walking for a period of time. And it's a world where your physiology is just working really well, you're losing weight on a weekly basis, you're feeling great. Yeah, you got some aches and pains, but you're engaging in all of these experiences with the wind, with the elements, with solving problems. And at the end of the day, you sleep so well every night in your down bag. And yes, I do take down. I love a down bag. And I'll do anything possible to protect, to stay dry. I love this part of the day when I'm on my hikes. I try and have a fire any time I physically possibly can. And I'm sure you heard of this phrase, but we would joke with it. And we call it Cowboy TV. This is Cowboy TV. This is one of the main channels, is watching a fire. There's another channel on Cowboy TV, which is watching ants, but then you got to be out for several months before that can be really fun to do for an hour. That's pretty bad. But, you know, ants are pretty incredible if you really pay attention to them, what goes on there. Some of those guys are wild. Hushu, this was one of my two guys I hiked with. You know that thing I told you earlier about when you think you might need to do something, you should be doing it? This guy and his trail name, we all have trail names. Mine is Uncle Tom's. This guy's trail name was Train. And the third guy that I hike with, you'll see him in the pictures, his trail name is Dick Wizard. So don't get me going about how he got his nickname, but really that's what his nickname was. I can't verify anything about whether that's true or not, but this is how it came to me. Train here was the exact opposite of someone that deals with things when they come up. And you can see that this shoe should have been replaced probably weeks, if not months beforehand. But even though he was in town, even though there were shoe stores, somehow Train would escape town with the same torn up pair of boots. So this is what it looked like on the last day of the trail for him. And yes, he was wearing darn tough socks. And he did have a hole in him, so. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about gear. I wear all wool all the time when I'm hiking. I loved it in the wintertime. I even love it in the summer. Unfortunately, it doesn't hold up that well in the thinner, like this is 17 micron short sleeve shirt from Ibex. I love the shirt. I can wear it in the desert. It's ultra thin. It breathes really well. It doesn't really, you know, have reek to it. But by mile, this is probably mile 800 from the straps just rubbing on it. You know, it just went. So wool is a great thing, but it has some drawbacks. Gloves. Nothing worked for me for gloves. I don't need to carry big gloves, but I do like to carry some kind of gloves if it's down in, you know, 30s or the 20s in the morning, usually light gloves. And then you worry about, well, if it rains, what are you going to have for gloves? I have still yet to solve a light glove situation of an all-around glove that works for me. If anybody knows of any, that's good. I do take a wool balaclava with me. I like wearing that even in the summer at night in the deserts or up high elevations. I like those Ulle Frotté balaclavas, those green ones. Really breathe well, really nice. Even if it's not real cold out, they feel really nice on my head. Let's see, eye protection. You gotta have sunglasses on these hikes. You're up over 10,000 feet. And it's really essential out west to wear goggles, especially if you're on the snow. I've experienced walking with people that were lax on that, and they did get snow blindness. There's really intense radiation up there. And then I talked about the sleeping bags. Myself and all my buddies, we prefer down, even though, you know, over the long haul, it can get dirty and it get oily if you're using it and sweating really heavily during the day, and then there's no water to wash up, which often happened. But we often would sleep outside like this. This is in southern New Mexico. This is up around 10,000 feet at one of the passes, and we were just sleeping outside. Another item that I wear out west that I never wear here is a wind shirt. We don't need them, but out west you really need them, and it's a thin, like a Patagonia Houdini is what I wear. I really like it. It weighs only about 6 ounces. It's really great in the wind. It sheds a little bit of moisture if it sprinkles. And I use it as a shirt around camp. I don't use it just as a windbreaker. It's just an extra shirt that I use. And by the way, I don't take spare clothing. That's how I keep my pack weight down. I'm just wearing what I have on. And when I get to town, I just change into my rain pants and my rain skirt, excuse me, and my rain jacket, and I put the stuff in the washing machine. I take it out, I put it on, and then I go. And if it wears out, I buy a new one. But you know, I try and keep my weight low. So let's talk a little bit about. There's my rain gear. That's my rain skirt. I like it a lot rather than pants. It's Velcroed and it's got a little button on the top because you're not restricted as much, you know, when you move. It's still nylon. Okay, so maps. Navigation was really difficult on the Western trails. I spent over $500 on maps on the Continental Divide Trail alone. I just needed that many maps, and you really have to have physical maps. I mean, I had a GPS, and you can load maps into that, but you're not going to be assured that it's going to, you know, die on you. So you need a map backup. And I didn't really leave my GPS on all the time either, because if I did, over a period of 150 days, I'd be spending a lot of money on batteries if it was on all day. So I would tend to shut it off until I hit an intersection that I was puzzled about, and then I would put it back on again and try and make sure that I was okay. So maps were a big thing. I like DeLorme. I like DeLormes because other hikers seem to take DeLormes, and they have the ability with a couple of the models that we use, the eTrex is what I like, to do a wireless transfer of data of tracks. So say I'm walking through, and it happened in Colorado, we had to change our plan because we had a wildfire that was blocking the official trail. I didn't have the track or the maps for the reroute, but a guy that I encountered did, and he says, oh, you got this, oh, we can do this right now. Just kind of, let's go hit track transfers, and in approximately 2 minutes, I had all of the tracks on my device that he had, so we went on. So let's talk a little bit, too, about adversity spares no one. I got these little stories that I'm amassing here right now. So I hiked with millionaires as well as paupers. This is it. We all look the same out there when we're hiking. You cannot tell who's a privileged individual after a month or two and who is a guy that's just barely scraping by. We all look the same. Same clothes, same dirt. We're walking the same trail. So I spent the night in Maine when I was walking the AT with a guy named Stumbles, and he was walking from Georgia, and he was probably about in his 50s. We had the same sort of gear, and he had a really nasty looking gash on his knee. I asked him about it, and he says, well, you know, I kind of fell, and then, you know, I didn't see him for a couple days. And then I saw his buddies like 2 days later, and I didn't see Stumbles, and I said, you know, what happened to Stumbles? And they said, oh, he fell on that knee again. And it really seemed to start looking bad. And he stopped in the town. We were in Stratton, Maine then. And he got a hold of a doctor, and the doctor said, basically, you've got a septic infection. You've got to get off the trail. You're done. You know, you've got to treat that, or it could get really, really serious. You could go septic. So he went home to Tennessee, and I said to the guys, geez, you know, poor guy, you know, he's so close, you know, he's within a couple hundred miles. Is Stumbles going to have the finances to be able to get back here next year and finish? I really would like to hope that he could finish. And they started laughing, and they said, you know, he sure does. The guy's like a multimillionaire. He like wrote this spreadsheet like 20 years ago, and this major company started after he sold it. He says, yeah, he can make it. Yet the person I show you right here, who I hiked a lot with, his name was Life Traveler. He had just turned 20 on the trail, high school graduate, worked a minimum wage job, washing dishes at White Castle in Johnsonville, Tennessee, and he made it. No money, he gets there. Stumbles is a millionaire, can't do it. So adversity spares no one. Is the lesson. Luck plays a big part of it, doesn't it? Luck really does. So what we basically do out here on the hikes that I did, I am getting some snow sooner or later, I'm looking at the clock, is we're hiking all day long. It's like morning until night of hiking. And we're basically on the I purposely started walking both the Continental Divide and the Pacific Crest to try and hike them in one season. I was on a schedule, no question about it. And my schedule had this little word echoing in my head, Canada, for both trails, because that's where you got to get to on both trails. So it wasn't a lot of leisurely camping. It was, as we said, it was an 18 to 20 mile pace that, you know, I had to do here. And at the end of the day, there was generally nothing left. You don't really have a lot to sit around the campfire and do. You want to just get in the sack and sleep, because you're going to wake up with daybreak. So let's go to the Pacific Crest Trail and talk about that. I'm skipping over the desert. I could talk to you about so many things about the desert, but I'm not. So I might talk to you about the desert in a few minutes when I talk about the Continental Divide Trail, because day one was unbelievable. But this is my watch, and this is the altitude of our first day over 10,000 feet in California at about mile 700 from the start of the hike. It was early June. It was around the first week in June. And what I'm going to take you through next are going to be the snow segments of the High Sierra. Up around toward Mount Whitney, to the east of Yosemite National Park, and you're looking out over, the desert on the eastern side. So this is the wizard out in front. This is the first snow we encountered outside of Los Angeles, really. It was about 50 miles east of Los Angeles. And this was at about 8,000 feet. This young individual here, Mr. Wizard, is not used to this. He's from Austin, Texas. He grew up in Texas, and they don't have this kind of snow in Texas. So I was fortunate in coming to Snowwalkers, and I was fortunate in living in Maine because I was familiar with how to move on snow. And I could show the other guys what we had to do. We had to kick steps. We had to make areas in the snow where if we slid, we wouldn't slide off and go down very steep slopes. So, Snowwalkers was starting to be pretty good. My snow experience was coming on here pretty well. So then we got going, and we got into, you can see the elevation on this sign, and it's pretty well buried in Sequoia. We're on both Sequoia and Kings Canyon here at 11,300 feet at this point. And a lot of this snow does melt, but it doesn't melt until later on in the summer. And we were up there in early June. So this is the kind of stuff that I encountered with my little pack, with the gear that you saw in my pack that I had to walk on for the next 400 miles. And this is the world. This is basically it. There's snow everywhere, and you're up really high. And thank God, you're acclimatized at this point, because it is hard to breathe if you were trying to do this with just coming off from Maine and just kind of jumping on there. It would not be possible. So I think I'll stop as I'm entering the snow here and maybe take a little break, slow down a little bit, take a look at the clock. And I think I'm doing good and on time, but I think I'd take some more questions now if anybody has any. Yes? I do not take snowshoes. No hiker that's doing these trails. I've only known one out of the hundreds of people that I saw on the trails that take snowshoes. And the reason why we don't take snowshoes is because look at the terrain. That's water and slush right down in there at the bottom. It could be frozen. And then you also see that there's a lot of sections where there is rock. You would be putting on your snowshoes, taking them off many, many times a day, and then you'd still have to encounter, and I'm going to show you that, the snow melt where there's actual lots of water that you've got to walk through. So in June, if that's all I was doing for a few days, I probably would take snowshoes. But with all the additional food we have to take when we're up in the mountains like this, we're often taking food for 10 days, 20 pounds worth of food. We're packing water as well. 3 or 4 pounds would be the lightest pair of snowshoes we could probably get, and even that would be too much. So no, we don't take snowshoes. We walk in the morning, though, when the snow is frozen, to try and stay on top, and then hopefully get over these high passes and then start to sleep at night at the lower elevations. But the snow does, and I'll talk about post-holing, we really do a lot of post-holing. So, question?
Trekking poles? Trekking poles on every
trip? Yeah. I learned about trekking poles after a big snowstorm hit in North Carolina in the Smokies. We were up around 6,000 feet, really deep snow, had to get down steep areas. I was slipping and sliding, and a guy I was hiking with, I'd never really encountered, lakey trekking poles before. We got down and he said, "Tom, You got to get some poles. You're going to get hurt. You're going to fall. You're going to go home." So since then, I have always used poles. I broke 6 pairs of Lakeys on the AT. They replaced every one. I never broke any more poles after that. I got a little better at being kind of a little more careful with my hiking on the PCT and CDT. But I do prefer them. I prefer the aluminum ones because they're a lifetime guarantee against breakage. The carbon fiber ones are only 1 year. So, yeah. Like I said, the question was, on average, how much does your pack weigh? It depended upon how many days I was out with my pack. So the basic pack itself is I got it down now to probably on that trip, it was 18 pounds without food or water. So for every quart of water, it's 2 more pounds. You try not to carry much water. And then for every day of hiking, it's typically approximately 2 pounds of food to fuel yourself. So if you're out for a week, and that frequently happened in the high elevations, that'd be 15 extra pounds added to 18, you'd have to be 33. If you're carrying 2 quarts of water, you'd be 38 to 40 pounds. And you were glad as you were going because you'd be eating up the food, it's getting lighter, you know, it kind of is a good thing. Okay, a question.
How is your resupply of your food? Do you have catches, do you have people, or how did you do that with your food supply?
A lot of people do it differently. I don't like to get a lot of food boxes sent to me. I would prefer to wait until I get to a trail that I have to then go down to find a road that I have to hitchhike on to get into like a town. Then I will usually like to get off about once a week at the most. And then when I'm in town, I just eat voluminous amounts of fatty foods, you know, pizzas, French fries, gravy, you know, hamburgers, cheeseburgers, ice cream. I'm losing weight like crazy. It's wonderful. It's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing. And then I'll usually like to take a bath, stay in a motel room, and then freshen up, wash my clothes, and then I'm back up there again. There was on the Continental Trail, I had to send myself eight spots that it just was impossible to get food, but there was little post offices that were close to the trail. So that's how I prefer to do it. Question?
Continuing on with the theme, when you talk about 100 sticks of butter,
yeah.
How does that translate into strips of bacon?
Okay, I mean, you're gonna eat all you want and you're gonna lose weight. I'm not kidding. I mean, giant loaded pizzas, I eat them, and then pints of Ben and Jerry after that, and it's no problem getting it down. Your body needs it, it craves it, and I'm still losing weight.
And cholesterol issues?
Oh, that's another issue. yeah. I never had problems with it until this last hike, and I was eating incredible amounts of junk food, candy bars, you know, Twinkies, Snickers, on this Continental Divide Trail, probably like maybe like 3,000 or 4,000 calories of food a day, still losing weight. When I came back, which is the bad cholesterol? Is it LDL or HDL?
LDL.
The LDL, my LDL was really high, and I'm now paying the price for it by really trying to eat, you know, kind of natural foods and see if I can't bring it down. I don't want to go on a statin. Yeah, it didn't do good for my cholesterol, this diet, at this age. When I was younger, it didn't make any difference. Yeah. Okay, any other questions? Yes?
When you're up high, what was your sleeping system?
My sleeping system, let's see, what did I have? What would I sleep on? I used to like to, on up high, I used to like to sleep in a tent. I have a small tent, it weighs a couple of pounds. And then on the latest hike, I've been through a lot. I like inflatable mats now, because I've got bad shoulders. I had surgery on both shoulders, and I'm about to get a replacement next year on this one, and it really hurts if on a hard pad. So I've been through X-Bed mats, I've been through, you know, NeoAir, I've been through them all, and I like the X-Bed for this one. It was, you know, it was down-filled, it was a shorty mat. And then I have a Western Mountaineering 20-degree bag that I got, a mummy bag, and I like them a little bit more girth. So you can order them that way. And if it's really warm out, which I will do in the middle of my hikes, in the middle states, I will send that home and then get a 40-degree bag, and I'll drop it. That bag will be about a pound and a half, that down bag. So that's typically what I do. Question?
When you wear gear out on the trail, how do you replace it?
A question. When you wear gear out on the trail, how do you replace it? Most towns around these trails have gear shops. And most of the great thing about it is a lot of the trails that I hiked are really have a lot of ski areas in the wintertime. You know, you go through Tahoe, you go through all of the ski areas, the trail goes all of the ski areas in Winter Park in Colorado, Vail. There's shops. And you just buy stuff. You just throw stuff away, you buy stuff. It's happening all the time. I probably replaced every single piece of gear I had other than my sleeping bag. You know, it all breaks. Everything breaks. Everything wears out. And you really want good relationships with manufacturers, too, so that if you call their 800 number and you tell them, look, my sleeping bag zipper broke Western Mountaineering. I need this bag as soon as possible. You want them to say, get it to us as soon as possible. We're going to push it out the next day and tell us how we can get it to you. And that's the best companies will do that. They really will. They'll try and keep you going. Yes? I did take ice axes on both trails, and I did use them. Not so much for cutting steps, which I did, but on incredibly steep traverses, planting the ice axe, kicking steps, and just in case you slip. You also need to know how to self-arrest. I took some courses in self-arresting at the EMS in New Hampshire, and you need to know that if you start sliding down that hill, how to stop yourself. And so yes, I did. But only for those sections, and then it was sent home. Any other questions? Okay, let me go ahead a little further. Oh, one more.
Your water needs, what were you boiling? Were you melting snow, or are you
looking we don't melt snow. We don't have the fuel for it. We just take enough fuel to be able to boil water to dehydrate some food or some noodles. So what I used, and I might have shown you a slide with it, SteriPen. I've had incredible luck. They've had a few different models over the years. I live in Maine. The company is in Maine. They provide me with their pen. They came out for this last hike with one called the SteriPen Ultra, and it didn't require any replacement batteries. It had an internal battery. You charge it off a micro USB onto the wall. You can do it on a computer. I had a small little anchor charger, which is like about a pack of, it's about this big. It's 5 ounces. I could charge that charger, and then I could charge my SteriPen with it if it ran out of juice. But that SteriPen would go on a full charge for about 2 weeks, and that's purifying 5 to 6 quarts of water a day. So it really did well. It never faulted. It was just rock steady, very dependable. What you do is, I don't know if you've seen them, but it's about this big. It weighs about 5 ounces. And you press a button, and it's got a long tube that's a UV light tube. And you put it down into your water. And then when it hits the water, the contacts light the thing up. And then it's preset to go for 90 seconds. And you're supposedly agitating the water with it. And you can drink it right after you're done. And the theory behind it is the UV light kills the DNA in any microorganism in the water, even down to crypto and giardia, so it can't reproduce in your gut and you can't get sick. And it's been around for decades. They've used it in India for a few decades. To big lights that they have in villages are, you know, so it's a good thing. No, you don't have to filter. If the water is clear, you don't have to filter. But if the water is cloudy, SteriPen says you have to filter. And you'll see some cloudy water when I go to the Continental Divide slides. Okay. All right, I got to go on. I'll take some questions in a while, but I want to move ahead a little bit, okay? So let me take you through some more slides of, just kind of like shooting some slides here. Like I said, I like to sleep outside as much as I can. This is in the Northern Sierra, pretty spectacular area. This is me below Mount Whitney. This is where I had to sleep. I tried to get up Mount Whitney the next day, and I wasn't able to do it. It was off the trail about 5 or 6 miles, and I woke up at around 2 or 3 in the morning, and I got pretty far up, but then there was no switchbacks to follow. It was just pure kind of hard ice, just straight up kicking steps, and I just ran out of steam. It was one of those things where improvisation, sometimes it's better just to kind of like say, you know, it's not going to happen today. And I just turned around and came back. Okay, I wish I could, okay, I will walk up here and point to something. We're approaching here, the highest pass on the Pacific Crest Trail, and it's here. We didn't know it was there, because none of us had ever been there before, and all we got is a map. And at this point, I didn't have a GPS on this trail. I wasn't carrying one. I should have. No one else had one either. So we were just trying to figure out, which place here do we go up? And there are no tracks, because it melts so quickly in the afternoon that any trail that someone might have laid down the previous day just gets obliterated. So it was really difficult, kind of like eventually being able to get to that point. But this is what it looks like. And this is looking backwards. I mean, we were hiking typical. This was not a typical year in the Sierras. This was a high snow year. Because it was so cold in the summer, the snow did not melt. So these are very unusual conditions for people doing this hike. This is one of the guys that I was hiking with, General Lee. This is in that same area. And this is us drying out our socks at the end of the day. You've been there, probably. I don't like to do this. I don't like to put my socks on a fire. I'm a big fan. I think someone mentioned yesterday that you could dry socks on your chest inside. Inside your bag. I don't put them on my chest, but I wring them out as much as I can, and I put them beneath my sleeping bag, between my my pad and my sleeping bag on my back, and it really does dry them out incredibly well during the night, and then I'll often get up to pee, and they'll seem not too damp, and then at that point, I'll just throw them in the bag until the morning, and usually they're almost pretty dry in a down bag. I'm gonna show you some water crossings. This could be a video. You might pick up a sound. You're not picking up the sound. Yeah. Okay. But this is some of the streams that we have to cross. They're kind of like this. I'll show you some other things next. We're doing a lot of this, water crossings. Some are deeper. Some are up to your waist. They're pretty dangerous. It's really ice water. It's cold. This is Forrester Pass. This is the highest point on the Pacific Crest. This is what I showed you, that notch that we finally found. And it's at the top, it's 13,300 feet. So we weren't quite sure how. This was the first high pass, and we said, geez, we hope the snow isn't really going to be an issue like this. When we came over the side, this is what we saw. And it was like, holy crap. You know, wow. So we're walking here with our usual stuff, and a couple of the guys are in shorts, and this is it. We're going across this kind of water. This is the kind of melt water that we had. And it's pretty challenging stuff. That's a frozen lake down there. And this is where snow walkers really came in handy, is just learning to cope with, just being not too freaked out by the snow. And essentially, from 10,000 feet to any higher, there was no Pacific Crest Trail for hundreds of miles. It was gone. It was buried. We couldn't find it. We got into total map reading at this point. We did have maps. We had compasses. And we were just sizing up, you know, valleys. We were sizing up, you know, what does the terrain look like, just orienting the maps, and just going overland at this point, and trying to find some place at night to be able to sleep. Okay, here's a good, well, you're not going to get the volume. I might just skip this because I want to keep going. Okay, so I've taken you all the way through California. I now want to finish up with the PCT so I have time to be able to do the rest of it. This is in Washington State. This is Mount Adams. Those are all glaciers on that side of Mount Adams, and we were camping right below that. And that's, you're looking at my tent in the back to the left there. It was 33 degrees here, and it was the most incredible thing. It was like, as the day went on and we were setting up camp, all of a sudden this wave of ice-cold air just started coming just right down the meadow, and it was just rolling right off all of that mountain, off that north slope with those glaciers just coming right at us. It was quite a thing, really something. And that's a picture of me with some more volcanoes in Washington up ahead. We went ahead a little further, and this is a section of trail called Goat Rocks. The Goat Rocks in the Cascades, the Northern Cascades. The trail goes through there. There's sections here where there's glaciers on either side of you. It drops off. It was about 4 miles on this kind of a ridge, just way, way up in the air. Pretty spectacular stuff. And more snow walk here. And I just want to really clarify, I mean, this is probably the extent of our camping, which is just talking about, you know, the harrowing experiences we had during the day, getting a campfire going. There's a bear canister right there. And then, and it's just this incredible routine. And my friend Pat Bergler, who had some great quotes, said, "We defeat these trails through persistent and relentless application of routines." You know, we get up the same time in the morning, we try and just kind of plot it out, we try and take breaks on a regular basis, and we just keep moving forward. So we're in Washington State now, where they had this phenomenal rain about a month ahead of time, broke down and washed out a number of bridges. Here was one of them that just got cracked and, you know, lowered to the ground. And I'm finishing up here right now with Washington State. It's really beautiful there too. There are these larch trees really up high. You're seeing that right here. We're finishing up that type of a trail. It would start to rain a lot. It would break. There'd be some sun. And what you're looking at here is an incredible place. Glacier Peak. We're on the side of Glacier Peak here, which you cannot see the top of. It's just a towering thing. And we were, the folks that I encountered, we encountered a few more hikers here. We took the time to dry out our gear, and it dries incredibly fast in high elevations when it's sunny out. And in a half an hour, stuff that was really wet was able to be dried out. I'm going to skip this because I don't have any volume. And then in the end of this trail, guess what? It's September, and the ice is starting up already in middle of September. So we're pushing ourselves to try and finish as much as possible. And it's really getting slippery. It's snowing at night, and we're moving as best as we can to kind of finish up with that. So that's the snow sections of the Pacific Crest Trail. And I want to move now to the Continental Divide Trail. And I might try to just keep moving here and take some questions at the end. So let me tell you about this trail. You can't see it. It starts in southern New Mexico. Then it goes through Colorado. Then it goes through Wyoming. And then it goes and it ends in Canada, in Glacier National Park, through Montana. You pass through so many national parks. You pass through Yellowstone. You pass through the Bob Marshall Wilderness. It's just an incredible experience. So here's some statistics from that hike. Somebody was asking some statistics, and it's kind of fuzzy. I'll read them from. I'm just going to take a few of these. This trip was 2,500 miles. I was out for 152 hiking days. No, excuse me, 152 total days. I took 28 days off, about once a week. Total number of hiking days, 124. Average miles a week, 106. And then it goes down. My longest day here was 38. Number of days, look down about two-thirds of the way, over 20 miles was 59. So roughly half the days were over 20 miles. And then 40 days between 15 and 20 miles. And then some shorter days after that. This is a water, typical water source at best on the Continental Divide Trail. It's totally contaminated with cow shit. It's total muck. So your question was, who was asking about filtering? You had to filter. But what I had to filter was my bandana. And you just take your bandana, you put it in your, you know, your Nalgene, you pour the water in there, it looks better than it did, then you do it again, and then until it's fairly clear, and then you hit it with the SteriPen and hope for the best. That's it. Yep. It still tastes bad, and there's stuff swimming in it. There's little stuff swimming all over the place in it. Yeah. This wasn't the worst place that we took water out of either. The worst places were just scooped out of the ground and in the mud, and the cows were in and out of it, and that's one of the places I remember having to get water out of. So this is the beginning of New Mexico. I'll go rather quickly to show you how bleak it was in the desert. That's it. That's what it's like hiking in New Mexico on this trail in the beginning. It's a lot of road walking. Some of it is across the desert like that. This was day one. We hit a sandstorm, which I've never experienced in my life, or even at snow walkers. Didn't help me any there. The wind got up to about 50 miles an hour, and we didn't quite know what a sandstorm would do to us and what to do with it until you see this wall of sand coming right at you, and everybody knew what to do. It was just choreography. It was just like this. It was just down and just kind of cover your eyes and just sandblasted for around 2 minutes, and then kind of you go. So New Mexico is wild. I don't want to ever go back there again. I really don't. Let's take a look at this. The wonderful thing about these trails, though, is you camp wherever you want. There's no one out there. You camp wherever you want. Occasionally, very rarely on this trail, we hit some private property that we had some hassles with some landowners. But for the most part, it's wide open. It's totally cool. And on the Continental Divide Trail, it's only 70% complete. So in the sections that aren't complete, you choose where you want to go. You choose if you want to go up high over the high peaks. If there's a lot of snow, you can take an alternate route and go around some lakes. You can go east, you can go west. There are four or five major portions of this trail where you're totally free and it's totally kosher to just make your own adventure, which I loved. This wasn't so good. This is the private property sign. We did have a lot of hassle with a landowner here who was really pissed off that we took, you know, about 4 quarts of water out of his water tank. He came at us in his gator. He was pissed. He didn't like it. He said we're taking money out of his pocket. He felt it was his land, yet we were told with our guidebooks that this was a county road. These landowners don't own it anymore. But tell this guy that. He didn't believe that, so that's what we had to cope with. Wasn't much fun dealing with pissed off landowners on top of everything else. So you get shade where you can take it, and here's us getting some shade over here in these pipes. I kind of like this shot, how it turned out, with the crew I was hiking with there. New Mexico is a barren desert. Right now, New Mexico is in year 8 of an incredibly severe drought. They had only gotten 0.04 of an inch of rain from January until this was probably this is still in May probably. I'm begging water. We had no alternative here. A spring that was on our guidebooks as totally dependable was dry. So we expected we were going to have water. This is an area that we slept in a parking lot as well. And we couldn't go any further because there was no water ahead. And it was assumed that we were going to get water at the last place, which is about 2 miles before this road. So we spent the better part of an afternoon. There were four guys. A total of four of us. We were just flagging down the very rare cars that would go by and begging water or drinks. And we had to do that all that afternoon. We slept there. We didn't have enough. We each needed at least a gallon to go to where we're going. And we spent the next morning kind of continuing to flag down cars. And let me tell you, a lot of people don't like four really grubby guys that are all ripped up doing this, you know, and for them to stop. So people are just, whoosh. I remember one lady, I think she believed us, but all she would do was she would just roll down her window a little and whoosh. The bottle just went out and she just sped off. She just kind of kept going. This was a part of New Mexico that had water. We chose this. This was one of the routes that we took. This is the Gila River. And you walk 100 miles up this river. You cross it 130 times. And it's an incredible canyon that you're walking through. It was really a cool thing to do. But I'm going to bring you to some water, some snow too. This is the Gila River. This is me. On the left with my friend, we encountered another hiker here, and it's this guy. His trail name is Breeze, and it turned out he was from Maine. I didn't know him. He was an ex-Special Forces Army Ranger who had been
through, you know, Afghanistan, Iraq, and he was completing hikes of these major trails as well. We really hit it off. He ended up hiking with us for a bit, and he ended up finishing the trail as well. So we're in Colorado now, and I'm going to take you up to some snow. This is in northern Colorado. We got a ride from this train. You know, I told you we hitch into towns. Well, this time we could take a train back to the trail. This is the Toltec Railroad here in Colorado. This railroad was put together in 1880. This railroad dates back to 1880, and it's up at 10,000 feet. It's the longest and highest narrow gauge railroad in America. And it was really cool to ride on this train for 14 miles. And we got dropped off here, elevation 10,015 feet. We didn't see any snow when we dropped off, but within 5 hours, here we are again. And it's the same guys I was hiking with in California. So they go, uh-oh, here we go. And same thing. I'm going to go through the same sequence, so I'm going to go through it fairly quickly here in order to finish on time. But we're walking on snow again. And we're camping in mud. I'm remembering snow walkers. And it's pretty bad. And all night long, our tents were battered by really high winds here. It was a spot that was not a good spot, but it still was one of the few spots that we could get a flat spot of level ground here. So, what happened was we started getting to some very difficult terrain. I almost broke my leg here. And what happened was we were seriously post-holing. This snow was much worse than in the Sierras because there was more trees. And there was more blowdowns. And there was more stuff that you would get snagged on as you're trying to walk around with no trail. And we were post-holing like hell. And at one point, I was coming down a really steep embankment trying to get around a bunch of fallen trees. And I was post-holing, and my left knee went down. And I started, my momentum was carrying me forward, but my knee was not breaking away. And I was feeling my knee was just going to stay there, and I was going to hyperextend it and snap it. And at the last moment, it broke free, and then I just kind of tumbled down. And at that point, a couple of the other guys had just fallen. And we just said, you know, this is it. We're done. We got to get out of here. We're gonna get hurt. Our trail is going to be over. And at that point, we pulled out accessory maps that we take. The DeLorme Gazetteers. Do you have a DeLorme Gazetteer here? Yeah. What we took on this trip was not only these narrow strip maps of the Continental Divide Trail, which were probably quite narrow. They only were about a 2 mile, you know, like ribbon. But we took pages from the gazetteers for every section in the snow areas in case we had to get out, and that's what we did here. We were able to study the gazetteer to the east and see that there was a little town and maybe there was people in it. And we got off and these guys' feet were really bad. This is after 4 days of snow travel, and we were very happy to get out of here and make this decision. And there's just more snow that we were encountering when we went back again after we went around. Some mountain goats to high Colorado. Some incredible, incredible country in high Colorado. And we're having to negotiate these cornices here, which we didn't have to do. And these cornices are at the highest kind of passes. There's usually these large, 20 feet high, sometimes higher, and they're melted in a way so there's like a wall that you got to get up and then get on top of the lip and then get over. And that's what I was seeing here is my two buddies already on top of one of these walls. And now I had to kind of like somehow kick my steps straight up and kind of keep my, I don't like heights, and keep my senses about me so that as I was going up there, I wouldn't freak out and freeze. And so you need to, that's why I'm saying anxiety is something that we need to manage, you know, when we're in many of these situations. And I was able to do so. That's me. I'm on the top of Mount Elbert, which is the second highest mountain in the continental United States. It's 14,400 feet. It's pretty cool. It was 4,000 feet of elevation that we had to walk that day. We actually started at 10,000, so we didn't have to, we only had to walk up 4,000 feet and down 4,000 feet that day. And it wasn't even on the trail, it was a side trail. But this is typical of these cornices going down, showing you the poles, why it was important to have the poles. They really help hold you back. At this point, I don't think we had ice axes here. I think we were relying on our poles at this point. Do I see him with an ice axe? He might have one on the side of his pack. There's another smaller cornice. And now we're on the divide itself in Colorado, just showing you segments with snow in it. And the trail is really right on the tops. This is the Continental Divide itself. You can see just to the right there, the you can't see it too well, but the trail is, this isn't that clear, but the trail is over here, and then it's kind of winding its way up that way there. And much of the same here. So, I like this. This is from God. Do you have any idea where you're going? This was a billboard that seemed very appropriate. And you remember when I told you I was lost? It was right around here, too. So this billboard was like, holy God, you know, I didn't have any idea where I was going. But I'll tell you, it's really good to know how to use a GPS. I had one on this trail. And it's really good when you press the button to know where the hell am I, and you could get, you know, a reading. And then you had a DeLorme map, and you took the time before you went on the trip to calibrate so that your GPS was in the same datum as the DeLorme maps, and you could tell exactly on the DeLorme map where you were. And then you could see where the trail was, and then you could see, oh, I got to walk east now, or I got to walk west. It was really important to have navigation skills on this trip. We were walking through parts of Yellowstone that were wild. And this is what happens on the outskirts of Yellowstone. You're going to encounter hot springs that have no warning. You certainly don't want to be night hiking in this part of the country and end up in one of those things, you know. So it was kind of dangerous, parts of Yellowstone. There are bears there as well. There's buffaloes. It was an interesting place. And guess what? I told you my trail name was Uncle Tom. There's a trail named after me in Yellowstone National Park, Uncle Tom's Trail. I loved it. Everybody else did too. They wanted my picture there. So you can see I'm kind of thinner than I was. Do I look kind of, see my jaw? It's like kind of, I kind of look like a chicken, my neck there. Yeah. Talk about animals. Lots of animals, in Montana, in Yellowstone, ends up in Montana. We saw, and in Bob Marshall Wilderness is where we saw more animals in one day than in several months of walking. We saw bears, we saw tracks of and I'll show you some of the tracks of wolves. We saw lots of elk, deer, small rodents, lots of birds. It was really quite remarkable. Getting into Wyoming, oh yeah. Yeah, the problem here is, I had another problem. I started to get, okay. I'm going to go pretty quickly now. I got a cracked tooth. I had tooth problems here. It was really bad. I couldn't get it fixed. I spent the rest of the hike, which was another month. I couldn't get anybody to fix my tooth. Any place I went, they wouldn't do it. They just said, oh, no, we're too busy. And it was terrible. I was just using antibiotics to try and whack it out. I'm going to go really quickly here because my time is about up. This is the Great Divide. It's a section of Wyoming, which is unbelievable. It's 160 miles of this. This is the original Oregon Trail. The groove is still there. We walked across that. This is some broken stuff that happened to me. This is some boots I had to, cut up with holes in them because my foot was starting to hurt. This is the Wind River Range, and I'm speeding here. Looks like it, you been there? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's gray, it's rocky and pointy, and there's lots of water. And this is forests that are burned that no one realizes how many. This is what it's like to walk through those burned forests and how dirty your feet get. let me take you quickly through grizzly bear stuff. OK, Okay, we encountered a grizzly. I'm going to tell you about that because it's so good, and I'm pretty much done. Between the Yellowstone, the Bob Marshall Wilderness, and Glacier National Park live 1,000 grizzly bears. They know where every one of them is. They got them all radio collared. There are 1,000 grizzlies that you have to avoid as you're going through there. You do see signs of them at night like this. And while you're walking during the day, you want to be making noise. This is what we did. We carried bear spray. I had it right on my chest. I had another extra one right on my waist belt. I wasn't carrying any guns or anything like that. But we were walking down the trail, and I'll play you the scenario. We're in a brushy area. The wizard was first. I was second. We're going through. We're making noise. And then all of a sudden, this was the guy. Scream, I didn't hear it. It was the most amazing animal sound I ever heard. It wasn't quite the roar you hear on television. It was more of a loud, kind of like a scream. He jumped back, Lewis jumped back, the bear jumped back, the bear stood up. I tried to get my thing ready, and we were able to get a shot off. He didn't come at us, and he basically just stood up, looked around, and then sauntered off and just started tearing into like a downed tree, just eating grubs and stuff like that. And we just kind of gave him a wide berth and went right around him. We encountered like three other grizzlies like that. This is what some people do for grizzlies. That's like the biggest gun I've ever seen. It's an 8-pound, 50 caliber bullets in there. This guy's a hiker. This is his hiking setup. Yeah. We discovered amazing stuff. How about this for an elk hunt? This guy was walking out. We saw him. He was a hunter, and there's his kill. He's walking out with the head of an elk, and his dog is eating the meat off the head as he's going. This wasn't a stage shot. This is really it. Wolves, forest fires that we encountered, we started to put out. I mean, it's wild world out there. This was from a fire strike, and it was smoldering, and it was going to fire. We basically were peeing on it. We didn't have any water. We didn't know what else to do. We did the best we could, you know, really. And then we're finishing up. We went over Lewis and Clark area, more burn zones, and I'm going to take you into, this is Glacier. I'm going to go quick. It started raining again. Things got bad. It's an astounding place. There's glaciers all over. Look at Grinnell Glacier way in the distance. The trail goes up through there. This is the most beautiful place I've ever hiked, is Glacier National Park. It is absolutely astounding. And you can get on a train and get there. The Amtrak goes right over there. And it lets you off right in the middle of the park. This is me, kind of ripped up, kind of grizzled, looking kind of old. We didn't have a fire. I'm putting this here because we wish we had a fire. There were fire bans in Glacier, even though it was raining all the time. And then it started snowing again here. And this was our last day, just making it out really miserable, really glad to be done. This is September 17th, and we just made it, you know. And there I am, you know, at the end of the trail, being pretty happy. With my water bottle, it also got the Triple Crown. Tiki man, it's kind of like he's a tiki man. So that was it. I'm gonna stop. Maybe we got time for questions, maybe we don't. And then the last thing I wanna tell you is, there's my tent. That's what I'm gonna be doing from now on in the winter time or around snow, is being back in the heated tent again. I'm done with camping and hiking in the snow, in the cold, without heat. This is a good thing you guys got going on here. Spread the word.